Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon and welcome to the installation of Charles Zukoski as the Shelly and Ofer Nemirovsky Provost Chair and Senior Vice President for Academic Affairs. And now, please welcome the Academic Deans of the University. Dean Amber Miller, the USC Dana and David Dornzive College of Letters, Arts, and Sciences, founded 1880. Dean Catherine Quinlan, the USC Libraries, 1880. Dean Haven Lynn Kirk, the USC Roski School of Art and Design, 1883. Dean Robert Cudieta, the USC Thornton School of Music, 1884, and the USC Gloria Kaufman School of Dance, 2012. Dean Laura Mosqueda, the Keck School of Medicine of USC, 1885. Dean Andrew Guzman, the USC Gould School of Law, 1896. Dean Avishai Sadan, the Herman Ostrow School of Dentistry of USC, 1897. Interim Dean Gareth James, the USC Marshall School of Business, 1920. Interim Dean Suzanne Wenzel, the USC Suzanne Dwork Peck School of Social Work, 1920. Dean Elizabeth M. Daly, the USC School of Cinematic Arts, 1929. Dean Jack Knott, the USC Sol Price School of Public Policy, 1929. Dean David Bridell, the USC School of Dramatic Arts, 1945. Dean Willow Bay, the USC Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism, 1971. Dean Pincus Cohen, the USC Leonard Davis School of Gerontology, 1975. Dean William Holder, the USC Leventhal School of Accounting, 1979. Dean Anthony Bailey, the USC Bovard College, 2015. And now, the Provost and Senior Vice President for Academic Affairs, Charles Zukoski. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the President of the University of Southern California, Carol L. Folt.
Chip, where are you? Wow, this is pretty exciting. Good afternoon, everyone. It's great to see everybody here on such a wonderful occasion. The installation of a provost is a very important moment in the life of the university. For USC, it's an occasion for celebration and reflection, and it represents a major step in our new journey together. Today, the Trojan community is welcoming Charles Zukoski, Chip, as our new provost and the Senior Vice President for Academic Affairs. He's also going to be my closest partner, working together with our students and our faculty, our staff, our alumni, our community partners, to really realize the grand mission for the university for the coming decade. I'd like to begin by introducing the university trustees who are joining us today. Would you please stand so we can recognize and thank you as a group? I'd also like to take a moment to recognize our senior administrators. They too will be, and in fact already are, working with Chip to advance a very ambitious research global mission. Would all of our senior administrators please stand and join me in welcoming them? I'd also like to have us give special thanks and notice to Elizabeth Grady, who served so well as our interim provost. Elizabeth. We're also very delighted today to welcome Chip's wife, Barbara Morgan, an accomplished physicist and also small business owner, their sons, Nick and Andrew, Chip's mom, Elizabeth, and his sister, Robin. Would you mind standing so we could welcome and recognize you? And they're joined by some of Chip's friends and colleagues that have come from near and far to celebrate Chip and to celebrate USC's brilliance in selecting Chip. Could you stand and we can welcome you, friends? Thank you. Thank you all for being here. You are now officially all a part of the Trojan family. Also joining us today are two extraordinary friends of USC, Shelly and Ofer Nemirovsky, who endowed the provost chair that Chip now holds. Would you mind standing so we could thank you? Okay, I know the big question that many, maybe all of you, are thinking, and that is, what is the provost? Well, plain and simple, the provost is the person who's responsible for the intellectual vitality of our university. It's the provost's job to help create and to nurture the very best environment for teaching and learning to thrive, to help develop programs and to foster an inclusive and caring culture that enables our students and staff and our faculty to discover, to create, and to thrive. As one administrator put it, the provost is the guardian of the academic soul of the university. And of course, the president is only as good as her provost and their teams of leaders, the deans, the senior leaders, and all of those who help run the university. And I thank you all for being such an important part of that team. Now I'm going to be looking to Chip to always keep in sharpest focus the needs of our students and our faculty and our staff. The provost has to understand and build diversity and equity along with excellence. The provost has to be the consummate, respectful team leader. Our 17-member search committee, chaired by Mark Humayun, and I know I saw Mark here, professor of ophthalmology, was also the consummate team. Could I ask any members of the search committee to stand so we can also say thank you to all of you? Hi, Mark. I know a lot of our faculty are actually teaching right now, so couldn't be here, but the team was so wonderful, and they evaluated more than 300 different names and people, and I really couldn't be more delighted with their choice, who was also their unanimous first choice. Chip is a chemical engineer. His research focuses on suspension mechanics, protein crystallization, and nanoparticle self-assembly. That sounds pretty appropriate for a provost. He's earned many of the field's highest honors, including being named one of the 100 chemical engineers of the modern era by the American Institute of Chemical Engineers. He's also a member of the National Academy of Engineering, and he joins the Viterbi School with his academic position. I also love that Chip, who is the author of nearly 150 peer-reviewed papers, has continued to publish and teach, at least while he was carrying out his responsibilities as provost at the University of Buffalo. And he stayed connected and is still connected to his students and to his field. And he's going to tell you, when you talk to him, how critical that is to his own way of building a team and thinking about what it means to be a leader here at a great research university. He brings the most important personal qualities that the committee and I were also seeking to this position. He's unfailingly student-centered. My first view of Chip on his very first day was standing out at the fountain talking to students who were going by, and I loved that. He understands the power and the importance of our civic partnerships and our responsibility to be wonderful partners with our neighbors. He has experience in guiding efforts that have enhanced diversity and inclusion. He brings particularly strong global experience, especially in the Asia-Pacific region, where he served for 6 years as chair of the Science and Engineering Council, which promotes public sector research and development in the physical sciences and engineering in Singapore. He's also worked to advance interdisciplinary research, education, and engagement. And he understands very well the need for excellence in all areas of our university and knows what it takes to support leading schools and highly impactful thought leaders on our faculty. Now, he and I both care deeply about sustainability. And Chip recognizes that science alone can't solve a problem like climate change or other global challenges. He knows that those solutions demand expertise that comes from every discipline. Expanding teaching and learning across disciplines and taking advantage of the advanced tools and understanding of the day are the chief ways that we, that Chip, as our provost, will help move USC forward. And he knows that along with maximizing collaboration and partnerships and igniting creativity without slowing everything down by poor administration is the real job of the provost. So I see in Chip the personal qualities that a USC leader really needs. He has a wonderful sense of humor, and he's very candid. He doesn't sugarcoat truths. He's a lot of fun. We all have great conversations already and have developed a warm, collaborative relationship amongst the leadership team. But what I think I value the most is that he treats everybody with respect and he is a great listener. So I think he's exactly the person we were looking for. You're all going to have a chance to spend time with him, and I think you too will be inspired like I've been when you see his joy of learning and his belief in the transformative possibilities of higher education. So now it gives me great pleasure to welcome our new Provost Charles Zukoski to the podium. Last year, USC established the Shelly and Ofer Nemirovsky's Provost Chair, and it symbolizes the central importance of the provost in ensuring the excellence in our teaching, research, and academics across our campuses. It was made a reality because of the generosity of this remarkable couple. And Shelly and Ofer, would you mind joining us on stage? With a degree in English from Dornsife, Shelly really understands what makes a USC education exceptional. And with Ofer at her side, she has provided crucial support to her alma mater, including the gift to endow and name one of the residential colleges at USC in the Village. So this provost chair really does reflect the faith that this family has in our university and in the person who will help me and the rest of our team to lead it. So Chip, I'd like to present you with a miniature chair as a token of respect and gratitude for your role as USC's academic leader.
So here we go. Thank you. Isn't it elegant?
It is
very elegant.
Thank you so much, and please join me again in thanking the Nemirovskys for this wonderful chair. Okay, so now I'm very happy to introduce Chip for some remarks. Thank you.
Carol, thank you very much for that gracious introduction. And Shelly and Ofer, thank you for all that you do for USC. This is fabulous to be here and to have such a turnout of folks to welcome us. I can honestly say it's kind of fun. right? After having driven east on Route 1 from Western Canada to New Jersey, Route 1 in Canada, to Princeton, where I attended graduate school 40 years ago, Barbara and I completed that loop by driving from Buffalo to LA in late September of this year. Okay, we've only been here for 5 weeks. In the intervening time, we raised our family in Urbana, Illinois. I built a research program in chemical engineering at the University of Illinois, and I cut my teeth as an administrator at Illinois and at the University at Buffalo. Barbara and I and my sons, Andrew and Nick, who are here, traveled the world, worked with imaginative and creative people, and gained a sense of appreciation for humanity's common search for joy. In a sense, my last 35 years in higher education prepared me for the position that I now hold. Activities at Reed, where I went for my undergraduate degree, Princeton, where I received my PhD, Illinois, and Buffalo, not all of which were successful, but many of which had led to positive progress, were learning processes that culminate in landing me here at USC. Barbara and I have felt the warmth of welcome from students, faculty, and staff, and the Trojan family. In face of recent heartbreaks, I have been amazed and pleased at the way this Trojan family pulls together and that under President Folt's leadership, we are gelling as a strong leadership team. Barbara and I are enormously pleased to be here. Thank you for our welcome. And thank you to our family and friends and who have come from near and far and from all of you for being here with us today. Installations mark new beginnings. President Folt and I arrived at the start of the fall of the 2019 semester. This is a new chapter in USC history, and I look forward with great anticipation to see what unfolds. These remarks are my attempt to peer into the future and to imagine what this chapter will contain. USC is one of the world's great universities, innovative and ambitious. We are recognized as a global leader because of achievement, because of the quality of the education we deliver, and because of the on-the-ground impact of our research, our scholarship, our clinical care, and our creative activities. We have a proven history of excellence. We attract creative minds who are passionate about undertaking their mission. USC is inclusive, and our student population is one of the most diverse in the nation. Our students, faculty, and alumni are recognized for their accomplishments. We are innovators in the degrees that we offer, in how our degrees are constructed, in the breadth, creativity, and collaborative nature of our research, and in the way we engage Los Angeles and the world. We are an assembly of astonishing talent, and we have a tradition of doing great things. As a global leader, we are always being watched. That has good things and bad things on Saturday afternoons. As we enter this new chapter of history of this great institution, I recognize that USC is poised for change. Among the reasons for this are the thirst of the faculty, students, and staff to face the issues of the past few years and learn what went wrong, develop strategies to avoid repeating them, and move forward united to move on to address the opportunities of our age with intention, creativity, and energy. The high visibility cases of the past several years have led to a sometimes critical view of this university. Despite enormous contributions made by faculty, staff, and students to improving the human condition, the reality and the visibility of these cases means that USC has shown up as an exemplar of bad behaviors. To alter this dynamic, there's a profound need for reflection and humility and steps that clearly demonstrate that our actions are consistent with our core values. President Folt and I are committed to understanding the issues and putting in place policies and practices that demonstrate institutional commitment to moving forward in a framework that sustains the excellence that is embedded in USC and where actions are value-based and doing things are done, and these things will be done with all due speed. The need for immediate action in dealing with these specific concerns often obscures how higher education is being altered by macro-scale pressures impacting society around us. These pressures include alterations in global demographics, the shifting basis of our economy, and climate change. These pressures are compelling. They must be faced. Our society will be altered by these pressures, and in the process, USC will also change. In characterizing what we see in society around us, we often use challenges as a code word for forced, uncomfortable, and perhaps undesirable change. I take a different perspective. I see opportunity. We are undergoing climate change. We are a society with widespread injustices, and our population faces increasing disparities in health, in wealth, and in access to education. In face of all of this, creating a sustainable and just society of tomorrow is indeed a challenge. But in a more interesting way, the pressures we are feeling provide enormous opportunity. By addressing the realities of our time, USC will be recognized as a thought leader, as the institution to which scholars and students flock, because USC is and will continue to be the source of ideas, solutions, technologies, and creative processes. By addressing these realities, we at USC will become the place where everyone must go to be educated, because if you're not educated at USC, you simply won't be at the leading edge. The opportunities and excitement lie in not dogmatically replicating the past, but in being excited to tackle the issues we face as a planet and a society. There is an adage when you're faced with change that people need to lead, follow, or get out of the way. I see USC leading. We aspire to change the world. USC enjoys an abundance of talent, resources, and commitment. With these assets, we will take advantage of opportunities we are presented and advance towards our goal of being a force for good, providing the next generation of leaders and professionals with the foundation they need, and as important for our society, for advancing joy. On climate change, we know how to reduce CO2 emissions. We know how to alter land usage and produce better foods. We know how to alter water usage to save streams. Certainly, we need better understandings and technologies to make these things easier. But many of the technologies exist, and yet we are making very slow progress towards sustainability. Social, cultural, and political structures bar the way. USC will lead in lowering these barriers. The density of humans in urban environments brings social and economic advantages. However, the resulting density results in new problems. LA experiences these issues deeply. By continuing to focus on the problems of LA, USC can expand itself as a beacon for those who seek solutions to the thorny issues faced by cities globally. USC has exceptional health sciences capabilities. As the cost of delivery of healthcare increases, new mechanisms of compensation are being put in place to help mitigate the financial burden healthcare places on society. There's a growing need for community-based wellness initiatives and translational research that focuses on ensuring not simply that, for example, diabetes is treated, but that social and environmental factors leading to diabetes are addressed and mitigated. As an anchor institution, USC must continue to embrace its leadership position in collaborative and translational health sciences. We can lead in building partnerships. We can lead in building partnerships that work within communities on health sciences issues, educational issues, safety concerns, and access to jobs. I believe we at USC are dedicated to building a society in which we all thrive, a sustainable culture in which disparities in wealth contract, where access to better health outcomes expand, and where despondency and radicalization give way to inspiration. But in the process of building this bright future, USC will also change. And one catalyst for that change will come in how the macro pressures we feel are impacting our finances. Now, don't kid yourselves. USC has abundant resources. We have talent, We have support and creativity that are the envy of the world. We have students and philanthropists who support programs that lead to fabulous outcomes. We know how to grow resources. At the same time, there is no question that USC is faced with some challenging financial times. Our operational costs are increasing faster than the rate our revenues are increasing. This is not ideal, and we have to adjust. The fact is that this is the catalyst for change that we will undertake. Mitigating the stresses we are beginning to feel might lead to disruptive outcomes. However, I would like to emphasize that USC has been disrupting for many years in all of the activities that we undertake. We are a leader because we have been disruptive. This is part of who we are and part of the culture of the community in which we live. From my perspective, USC has the capacity to deliver a wonderful future. With the abundance that is around us, I encourage us not to be bogged down by notions of scarcity, but to embrace the and proposition, that we can work within and expand the financial framework that constrains us, and we can accelerate into a fabulous future, and where USC continues to be known for astonishing programs in research, education, healthcare, and in our creative endeavors. In describing the activities of universities, we often speak in terms of multidisciplinary programs focused on grand challenges. This focus on problems is driven by the enormity of the issues that we face, and that resolving these issues requires expertise beyond a single discipline. Timelines for discovery to implementation have been shortened. The competition for making progress is ever growing. The consequences of not making rapid progress are enormous. Thus, rather than sequentially addressing issues and passing the results between disciplines, there is a growing call to have individuals with deep domain knowledge work together on teams to address the problems. Much of what we do in the next chapter of USC's history will be multidisciplinary. At the same time, great universities must continue to inspire. Inspiration comes in many forms and is intrinsically individualistic. At USC, we have the talent and the capacity to remain in the business of undertaking activities that are inspirational and motivational. Often these inspirational activities have a narrow and deeply disciplinary focus. Our society is only rich enough to have the rare creative mind pursue its passions. As faculty at USC, we are given that freedom. But enjoying this privilege, we must also accept the obligation to deliver inspiration and joy at the cutting edge. Colleagues and friends, there is so much opportunity to inspire, to build towards a sustainable and just future, to engage with the problems of dense urban environments, to face challenges of educating the next generation. USC has grappled with and will continue to grapple with these issues. We embrace opportunities before us. The next chapter in USC's history will be born from our passions and our capacity to make choices. I started these comments with reflections on how I arrived at USC and the experiences that shape how I perceive the world. These experiences have made me a believer in observing, listening, hearing, and debating. I'm also a believer in setting priorities and making decisions in a timely manner based on those priorities. I believe in a process of continual renewal and the excitement of shaping programs of impact. I believe the priorities should be value-based and the decisions should be consistent and predictable. My experiences have given me a belief in the joy of discovery, the pleasure of educating, and a great satisfaction in doing. In my short time at USC, I have learned the passions of the Trojan family, our capacity to be innovative, and our desire to change the world. I see an abundance of resources with which to build. I see wonderful opportunities of our times, and I believe USC is the place where the future will be developed. I am excited to be here, and I am proud to be your provost. Thank you.